Like a chrysalis, we're emerging from the economy of the Industrial Revolution. An economy confined to and limited by the Earth's physical resources into the economy in mind, in which there are no bounds on human imagination, and the freedom to create is the most precious natural resource.
With my friend and co-host Ron Baker, and folks, on today's show we are live from the Media of Demise.
All right,
how's it going, Ron?
Great.
Get a lot of energy when we do this live.
Absolutely.
We were here what, 5 years ago? I think it was 5 years ago.
Four or five years ago,
before the world changed. But and we changed. It was that we were not even talking about the subscription economy the last time we were here. I think we were barely like even scratching the surface.
That's right. That's right. We did talk about it, but not to the depth that we're capable of talking about it today.
Yep. So here's the plan, folks. We're gonna talk a little bit about some of the latest developments and just the overall subscription economy, maybe the first 10 minutes or so of the show. And then we're going to take questions from you. So have them ready. We will have microphones that you'll be able to ask us questions about this and other topics. Think of this as a live Ask Me Anything. And Ron and I will opine on anything. We do mean that. So just give us what you got. We're happy to talk about it, business related or otherwise. But Ron, there's been some interesting chatter about subscription. Most notably, I think, that happened with NetSuite. Anybody else, guys, you see what happened with Netflix. Sorry, I have ERP on the brain. Netflix, where, right? So this is some people are saying that this is an indication that, you know, maybe we've reached peak subscription and people are, but Ron, what's the real story behind that? Because we did a little bit
on it. Yeah, well, the real story is Netflix Russia, because of the Ukrainian invasion, lost 700,000 subscribers. So they actually gained 500,000 subscribers in the first quarter. This year, they didn't lose. Now, they do say they are projected to lose 2 million subscribers to the end of the year.
So there is a potential challenge there. But they also do something interesting. And one of the things that we oftentimes will point out is Netflix canceled subscribers who aren't using it. They just outright canceled it. They'll say, you're not using this, stop paying us money. Which I think is a really interesting play when you're talking about subscription, that they would go that far and say, hey, listen, we're not going to take your money if you're not going to use our service.
Right. It's the exact opposite of possibly not. It makes sense because you're not getting value from the offering, they want to pay for it.
Yeah. So what else, Ron? What else have you been paying attention to in this whole subscription world?
Well, it's a couple of things. I mean, one is you probably noticed that there's a private equity play in the total space where you get your car lot. These private equity firms are going in buying these things. There's women who care where it's headed with the bank.
Talking about this in a session that I did earlier this week, and one of the guy said, yeah, I joined it and did exactly that. I would wash my car, five times a week. And then, of course, the second week, it was down to four times a week. And the third week, it's down to two times a week. And then it's down to maybe once every 2 weeks. He said, but I still keep the subscription because I get access to that lane. I don't have to pay. I don't have to wait. I just go right in, right out. And it's worth it just for that, even though I'm not having the car washed so often. So I think this is a really interesting play that can you develop an offering that gives top flight access to certain players, to certain customers? And that would make a huge shift in what you guys are doing from an experience because you are giving them the priority. And I think that would be something for us to really take a look at, seriously.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that teams, who's the CEO founder of Zor, which is a software platform that runs subscription-based businesses. One of the things he predicts is 5 years, you won't own anything, but you'll subscribe to everything.
The implementations by subscription, and it's going extraordinarily well. He said he has not lost a customer that first came on with it. In fact, he's at the time of renewal, and he says that people are renewing without fail. And he is getting more and more key conversations with his key customers. He started asking a question that I highly recommend the rest of you begin to ask your customers, regardless of whether you go to subscription. And it's a really effective question. We've tested this on a number of different places. And that is, tell me about the decisions that you or your company need to make in the next 3 to 6 months. So nothing about what software do you need, nothing about anything like that. Just what are the decisions that your company needs to make in the next 3 to 6 months? And lo and behold, the answer to like 70% of those things, you can help with. You're going to be able to develop data for. So there's going to be things, the show notes, as well as previews, upcoming shows. We are sponsored right now by, if you need a mind, get one at 90minds.com. But right now, a word from our sponsor.
Be sure to friend us on Facebook. You can do it right now. Visit Facebook.com/Voice America or search for us at keyword Voice America.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytics solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever read a book that changed your life? I sure have. Have you ever listened to an advertisement for a book so many times that you question the existence of God? Me too. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. I recorded the advertisement for Ron and Ed's book, The Soul of Enterprise Dialogues on Blah, 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 Whatever. And 4 years later, we're all tired of it, especially me. But thankfully, there's a solution. For just $10 a month, you never have to hear my voice again. For a commercial-free version of The Soul of Enterprise, go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe now. Have you listened to so many of my ads that it's corroded your soul?
I absolutely have.
What if I told you that you could listen to my voice for an entire podcast?
I'd say that approximately half of the podcast is actually my voice.
Hello, I'm Greg Kite.
And I'm Caleb Newquist.
We're launching a new podcast called Oh My Fraud.
Ron and Ed explore the soul of enterprise.
Caleb and I explore fraud, which is more like the herpes of enterprise.
Go to wherever you get your podcasts and download
Oh My Fraud.
We don't follow, we lead. Join us, the Voice America Influencers Channel. You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Welcome back, everybody. We're here live at the Meeting of the Minds, 90 Minds.
All right, let's hear it for 90 Minds. Woo!
And we're talking subscription. When we first started talking subscription, especially on the show in 2018, and with our colleagues and other groups that we speak to, there's a lot of questions and there's a lot of objections. And I struggled with this for a long time and still wrestling with it. There are many unanswered questions, but there's no doubt in my mind that this is. To another business model. In fact, it will be a stepping stone to another business model. But for now, our businesses are being compared to things like Amazon Prime and Netflix and direct primary care physicians. And as teams all likes to say, your business is either expendable or you're indispensable. And I think that's a really interesting distinction.
One quick pickup on this, Ron. I learned this yesterday at a session that I was doing up in San Diego. Actually, the day before, I'm sorry. And the Amazon Prime subscription, I don't know if you realize this, but remember when we couldn't get toilet paper on Amazon during COVID? Well, you had a guy who was in the class, and he said that he had previously subscribed to paper towels and toilet paper, and he was getting his deliveries. So Amazon was had actually withheld stock and was fulfilling those who had been subscribers to them first before they were trying to do any fulfillment with other places. And I thought that was just a brilliant part of the story, that if you had been a subscriber, they were holding stock for you.
Yeah. It's like we see these loyalty cards, you know, from your deli, pop shop, whatever. The subscription model kind of takes that to another completely different level. And because of the relationship being at the center, that's the new profit formula. And I think this is the tricky thing to understand, especially being mired in the traditional income statement or cost accounting mentality, is the profit formula is different. You're not looking at gross margins, you're looking at customer lifetime value. And that's what everything is about. So annual recurring revenue, monthly recurring revenue folds up into this customer lifetime value. And you can actually take all your profits and reinvest it in growing your customer base. As long as the bucket's not leaking, that's a very viable strategy. And the market values that tremendously, as we've seen with some of these valuations that venture capitalists and others are making these subscription businesses.
I'm just saying, that's hot. You want to talk? Not time for me to roll a little bit. I'm going to do my best Phil Donahue impression. That will date me significantly, Phil Donahue. So what I'd like to do is turn this over to you guys. We have to wait for the microphones so that we can capture the video. So questions from anyone? All right. Thank you, Sean. Hold it.
How's it? So first question, Ron, is for you. You recently did a podcast about keeping eyes on numbers, is that correct?
Right.
You talked about the need for professional service companies to remember that everything is based on relationships. And I wrestle with the dichotomy that these relationships, it's very difficult to scale, particularly as the earlier Ed referred to some services that are being done with volunteering. Be careful with this stuff and that. As they get deeper and deeper into the organization, they're being called in to truly be business consultants, not just a one slice of pie on very element piece of software or file. And as you build those relationships, there's an aspect of they have to get deeper in the organization. You can only do so many of those as an individual person. And they're not necessarily scalable or something you transfer from
This is a fantastic question. Something that I've been pondering quite a bit because we've interviewed Dr. Paul Thomas, four times on the show, as a direct primary care physician out of Detroit, Michigan. And he's got a great saying, and I can't disagree with this. Intimacy doesn't scale. We can try and fight it. We can try and work around it. We can try and think that we're going to build up services brick by brick by brick. But that's not really servicing the customer. That's just doing things for them. It's not really serving them. So these intimacy doctors, I think, should have a little, at least they work on a scaling issue in box. A deeply sick doctor only takes 600 patients and then they max out. And then they'll go out, get another doctor, and they'll organically and slowly. It's a slow growth model, there's no doubt about it. But they'll grow down to 400 or 500. And that's exactly what Dr. Paul has done in 4 years since we've known him. He's added 2 doctors, he's about to open up a second office and bring on another doctor. He's scaling, it is scaling, but it's slow. Because it is based on that relationship. It's not just based on those one and done services.
Yep. You want to talk about power?
I just emphasize the need for the professional service organization to make their own great job taking care of those professionals. Because the relationship with that customer is really no longer with the organization. Is that the people within the organization build that expand that out of boats, but at the same time, it's a little time on a one-on-one basis. I'm not going to go to psychologist in a month after I had to
really
accept my thing. We get a relationship, I just assume that someone goes to the internet as opposed to
Yeah, that's a really interesting point. You know, that whole dichotomy of do people hire McKinsey or do they hire the people inside of McKinsey? And usually, if you hire McKinsey, you have a deep relationship with your partners. But I think these deep seated jobs of shelf, when they expand their offerings, they might have a chiropractor or some other type of medical person that does different procedures and things. They also form connections with the patients. So it doesn't just have to be reliant on one person. Granted, this is a difficult model, but I'll tell you why. It's client advisory services, CFO, CAS, that's a different model to scale, because those skills are completely different than predictable, you know, type transaction type. So I think it's a challenging in a way of business model.
Yeah, and one of the models that I really like is it's hassle-free home services. The chanting on this from the hassle-free home services. This is what they do. What they do is they do anything around the house that you don't want to do. It's, you know, they check the popping around the toilets, they change the refrigerator, they change light bulbs, all of the stuff that they do. One thing I learned from on this website is you're supposed to drain half a gallon of the water meter every year. I don't even know that. Like, that was like a thing you're supposed to be doing. So they have all of these things, and they earn 50% of their revenue from the subscription, where they just want to do all the stuff around your house on a monthly basis. But it also is a gatekeeper, because what they do is they will also help you put in a pool or build a deck. So they will serve as the general contractor for that engagement. So I really like this notion of coming out with the marker of things that are fully covered, and that's the language we use, covered versus uncovered. But in order for us to do a project, to speak to our project manager, you first have to be on a subscription list on the maintenance side. So it really kind of flips the narrative. Instead of what we used to do, which is try to get the project and then getting to go on maintenance, it's the thing that we're going to handle the maintenance piece. And only then will we then build your files.
Yeah, and lawyers do this too, not less than for us to defend you in litigation and do something more complex than you have to be a subscriber first.
Any more questions here? It's going to be a long time because we will just keep talking. That's it.
Good.
You already got one in you now.
I do remember going back to Agent ourselves, Dave Felder. He used to talk about 80% of the customers who were on the ADP payroll service were dissatisfied, more dissatisfied state. Right? Because the cost of changing was, or the hassle of changing was worse than the hassle of working with them at the time. So if you talk about the Netflix answering people, are you seeing that beat fatigue, or that subscription fatigue, and how the providers are actually dealing with it today? Or are we just continuing to just suck the money out of the dissatisfied customers? Or are we actually changing our model, or what's happening? Because we know it's got to be out there.
Oh, it is. You're right. Subscription fatigue is real. It's more real in the business to consumer market than it is in the business market. I bet in your fund, you have all sorts of subscriptions, different software, different apps, whatever. It doesn't seem to be running out of steam B2B. But the thing that makes this new iterative subscription business model different than the old one is every touch point, you have the ability to answer. We used to preach the value guarantee and say, hey, if you're not satisfied, we pay what you want. The value guarantee in the subscription model is a cancel button. And that shows up on every email, everything that changes. Basically, cancel it, pause it. And I think that frictionless and that peace of mind and convenience for the customer is what's driving people's ability to subscription, because hey, I can drop it for a couple of months and I don't like it. I'm going to cancel it. I'm not locked into ADP. I can go find some other jobs.
you're still locked into the product, but we are again up against our break. This has got to pay the bills here. So I want to remind you all that you can contact me or Ron by sending an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Of course, we have the show notes as well as previews to upcoming shows. We do have that Patreon channel, patreon.com/TSOE. 90 Minds members, you automatically get that feed. All you have to do is get onto your server and find where the Patreon feed is for the Soul of Enterprise, and you get all of the show notes, shows commercial free, just like Geraldine Carter did at Smart Strategy for CPAs, and also Blake Oliver at Earmark CPA. He's a sponsor of our Patreon channel, earmarkcpe.com. But right now, a word from our sponsors.
Voice America is on your favorite smart speaker. If you have Alexa or Google Home, go ahead and give us a try.
Hey Alexa, play Finding Your Frequency podcast on TuneIn.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever listened to an online radio show that changed your life? I'm required to say that I have. Have you ever stopped listening to an online radio show because the commercials were mind-numbingly repetitive? Of course you haven't, because you're here right now. Look, you don't have to listen to me anymore. There's a commercial-free version of this show, and it only costs $10 a month. And for $15 a month, you get no commercials plus bonus content. Go to patreon.com/TSOE, subscribe now, and be free. You're worth it.
This is the Voice America Influencers Channel. Be inspired. You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Klass. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using #AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
And we are back on The Soul of Enterprise live at the Meeting of the Minds.
Yes.
Love that energy. Good, 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 good. And Gary, you were just talking about what we do want to hear a follow up of this. So your business has not been easy, even though you do have easy cancel, on easy off. Is that right?
Right. We always had the month to month, 30 days notice, blah, 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 you're done. Just because there's always a transition period. But I've had everything from the thank you for your loyalty over the years. We hope to be back to the well, you've paid so much in advance, so what we can do is we could reduce your service to this level and keep up that deposit over a longer period of time.
Right.
To, I'm sorry, we just renewed you 2 months ago. You're stuck for the next 10 months. Hmm. And it's been all over the board in terms of what people will do. But I think a lot of companies are still... Even in the ERP space, you know, you have a subscription. It's a 36-month subscription. Pay us, you know, either all of it in advance or pay it on an annual basis.
Right. Yep. You know, one of the things, though, that I think that we're learning, and this is how subscription really differentiates from what I used to call access level agreements, is what this notion of plussing. You know, Disney uses this term, you know, we have to plus the experience. And Ron and I have latched on to that. And the question becomes is, what is it that you're adding on? What are the new things that you're building into the subscription to keep people there? I usually use this framework. What is your equivalent of the new season of Ozark? Right? You've got to have exactly, which is a great show. Three cheers for Ozark. All right. But what keeps you coming back? So what are the things that you're adding on to your subscription over and above? Because if it is a static offering, well, yeah, then they might not see the value. So I think one of the things that subscription does is it puts us in a position of constantly having to innovate around new offerings that we can create. And what we've been talking about lately, and this seems to be the key, is offer it only the new things you can come up with to the top level, to the top prospect, to the top, whatever, who is ever in that top tier. And then over time, you roll that stuff down
right, to the second tier, to the third tier, but you're constantly adding new stuff into the top tier first, so that that's creating this additional value and to some degree anticipation of those that are in the lower tiers who maybe not want to support it, and also potentially a reason to shift up.
Yeah, the plussing is a really great point. Ed, tell them the iRobot story.
Oh, okay. So some of you have heard this already, but it's my favorite story to tell. I, just before Christmas, subscribed to a vacuum cleaner. And this is the iRobot from Roomba. So you guys probably heard that. But this one is like the real high-end one that has its own space station that it goes over. You don't have to even empty it because it empties itself into a vacuum bag that you take off. Well, this thing is also hooked up to the internet and pretty much tells you everything that it needs to know about itself. Like, you know, how far you've covered it. It sends you a little gamification request. Like, you've covered this the space of a basketball court. We vacuumed the space of a football field. Right? So all of these little gamifications badges come up. But what is also interesting is they will tell you, hey, your bag is getting full. We're sending you a new one. We're sending you a new bag. So when it gets there in the mail, switch it out. And then it's got sensors in it to know, all right, you put the new bag in it, right? And so it does all of this stuff for you. And what I realized, even after I was subscribing to the vacuum cleaner, that I wasn't subscribing to the vacuum cleaner. I was subscribing to clean floors. It was the outcome, once again, that I was subscribing to, not the input, not the vacuum cleaner itself, but the outcome, which I didn't even as a consumer realize. And I think this is the other thing that subscription really, really does, is it focuses you on trying to discern what is the outcome that the customer wants. What is that outcome?
Yeah, and Fender, the guitar manufacturer, they started Fender Play, which is their digital library of like 3,000 videos that teach you how to play the guitar at any level, from beginning to expert. And what they realized is when somebody buys a guitar, 90% of the people play it for a couple months and then give up because it's too damn hard. So the guitar goes under their bed or in their closet. They might even give it away to somebody else at some point, which is a lost sale to Fender. So they created this app, Fender Play. And during COVID, they had something like 1 million people sign up for it within 2 months because they gave a free trial. Because we were all locked in our home and some people wanted to learn how to play a guitar. And what Fender realized is we're not selling guitars, we're selling musicianship. So that's really cool.
It is very cool. But what's the equivalent of that? I mean, I'm not suggesting that, you know, doing ERP software is as fun as playing the guitar. It's clearly not. Well, for some people, you know. But I do think that there's ways for us to build this plussing in, this gamification stuff in, that really rewards it. One of the biggest things that surprised me in working through the subscription model is how much it changed my perception of project management. Like, I changed the way I even thought about, and I'm, you know, you know me, I'm big into waterfall and I taught classes and all of this. And I realized that, and I thought for sure that there was no way that you could make agile work in an implementation. But I think you got to shift to agile when you're trying to do this via subscription. You have to let the customer kind of guide the process as to what's important to them and making some changes. And here's the really cool part, is because it's a subscription, you're like, well, we don't have to rush to get this done. We can do what the perception is important to the customer and fulfill their needs earlier on, rather than wait around and say, no, you know, we have to do it in this order because I've got to do this, I've got to do this, I've got to do this. You can say, all right, well, we're going to be willing to play on this a little bit and do things a little bit differently to fulfill what your needs are for the next 2 weeks or 4 weeks, however you set the sprint cycle up. So it completely eliminates the idea of change requests. It goes away. Because what you're doing now is you're just saying, oh, okay, this is the stuff that's on the punch list. This is the stuff that's urgent. We're going to do these are the things that's important to you. And we're going to do them in the order that's important to you within reason, right? You can't do anything until you get the chartered accounts in. I get it. But, you know, there are certain things that you can emphasize for the customer value. And I think it would make a big, big difference for the customer, as well as their acceptance of it, because they're seeing value sooner rather than later.
Yeah.
Wait. Okay. So in terms of what you were just talking about, you're basically freeform adding and rearranging items on the punch list. And that's pretty much how you're working through the customer's timing on.
That's right. That's right. Prioritization.
Are there, could you give us an example of the difference between this approach, how you'd use this approach with, I'm not sure what project it would be, but what comes to mind in terms of the way you'd run it the old way as opposed to the new way?
I just try to give a very simple example, but I think it expands beyond this. You know, say traditionally the way that you've done it is, you know, you get your chart of accounts in, fine, and then the first thing you do is run your accounts payable. You want to get the accounts payable. Well, all of a sudden the customer says, hey, you know what, we've noticed we've got a real bad receivable problem lately. So you just chase and shift and say, all right, let's do that next. Now, that would have driven us crazy in the old way, right? To say that we're partially way through this. No, we can't start and stop. This would be in the middle of things. But the reality is that when it's a subscription, you don't care. I mean, it might be a little bit of a drag, but as long as you're making the customer more satisfied because you're dealing with the issue that is of concern to them. Does that make sense?
Yes. So how would you – can you run an implementation of a new package, ERP package, with this model?
Say that again a little bit louder, Jerry.
Can you run an implementation of a new package, say putting in Sage 100, changing out whatever they are, putting Sage 100 onto a new customer? Can you run that implementation using this model? And certainly it's a different degree than what you'd had before.
Yeah, no, I think you can. And what's more is as we talk about migrations to any product, it doesn't have to be, but you can just make that part of your subscription. Like that's just going to be part of when they do move to a different product at some point, there's no change for them. It's just that's what you get for being a part of being a member, right? Membership has its privileges. I love the old American Express tagline on that, right? So we're just getting one. And keep in mind what Ron said. Ron used Dr. Paul as the example and said that he only has 600 patients. The average GP, general practitioner doctor, has 2,500 patients, which is why you only get 5 minutes with him or her. And they are mostly doing data entry when they're talking to you. They got their head in the keyboard and they're like typing stuff in. But what Dr. Paul has done is gotten this down to 600 patients, and all his location doesn't have a waiting room, because he's able to deal with that each individual customer,
mm-hmm.
right? So it is a significant difference, a decline in perhaps the number of customers that you service, but you're spreading it across a risk pool of fewer patients,
sure.
allowing you to spend more time with them, which I think is a good thing. So.
And on the one-offs, because that's been the number one question that we probably get. How do you deal with a big installation or... For accountants, how do we deal with, cleaning up somebody's mess in their books or filing 10 years worth of tax returns, something like that? There are several different strategies to deal with things that aren't necessarily predictable or routine. One of them is just to have an upfront price for it. It's completely separate from the subscription. Another one is to tie them into a longer term commitment with the subscription, which I think violates the very spirit of subscription. Don't do that, because cell phone companies do that, and we all hate it. Now, one thing I did think was interesting is this idea of having a declining price. So you up the monthly subscription, and every month it declines until that one-off is covered, and then it reverts back to normal. I kind of like that. It's certainly better than a longer-term commitment, I think. Another one is to offer an enterprise choice where you just customize a subscription for this one particular client because they're an outlier. And another one is just trusting your value, just doing the work and saying, hey, the lifetime value of the customer is going to more than cover it. We're going to take this risk. It's not much different than going out and spending money trying to get a new customer.
Let me add one thing to that declining concept, because this plays on a different idea. The other thing that you can do is tie that decline in price to a specific deliverable or completion point, milestone, however you want to call it. And here's the thing. Then it becomes in the interest of the customer to say, yep, we're done. because we get the decline, right? Right?
Right.
Whereas previously, can you sign off on this? This is complete. No, we're not going to get the resistance to the sign off. Now there's incentive structure built in for them to say, yep, this is done. And so that they can have that decline in price. So I think that's a real, another interesting flavor that you can go about.
The other thing that I think, and this deals more with the psychology of subscription, but one of the things I think is really cool about it is it separates the pricing decision from the workflow. Because you're not doing scope, out of scope, have to get a change request, go to the department of paperwork, you know, have the client fill out this and that and ask, have a value conversation, all these things. No, they've made the decision to subscribe to your firm. And now you just need to do the work to keep them happy. Now, sure, you can shuffle around the priority. You can limit the number of projects you do at any one time so they don't consume, you know, too much of your resources. But you've separated the pricing decision from the work. And that's kind of brilliant if you think about it, because they're not having that cognitive load of thinking, oh, my God, is this worth it, and reevaluating the whole relationship.
It makes a big, big difference, I think, in my mind of the customer on that. So, all right. Well, we are up against our last break already. Want to remind you. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Phil, we'll get to you right after the break. So that you can get a hold of us at asktsoe@verisage.com. The show notes and full previews to upcoming shows are available on thesoulofenterprise.com. We also are sponsored, as you know, by Sage, which is my employer. So let's hear some commercials from them.
Follow us on Twitter at VoiceAmericaTRN. Get the lowdown on guests, new shows, and your favorites. That's VoiceAmericaTRN.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever been so annoyed by a commercial for a $5 ebook that you were willing to pay $10 to never hear it again? I sure have. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. Over the last several years, you've come to hate me, and I hate me too. By now, you know that for $5, you can get a copy of Ron and Ed's book. What you might not know is for twice that much every month for forever, you can stop hearing me plug Ron and Ed's book, which totally makes sense, like the Diamond Water Paradox. Go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe today. Please, for the love of God, make it stop!
Have you listened to so many of my ads that it's corroded your soul?
I absolutely have.
What if I told you that you could listen to my voice for an entire podcast?
I'd say that approximately half of the podcast is actually my voice.
Hello, I'm Greg Kite.
And I'm Caleb Newquist.
We're launching a new podcast called Oh My Fraud.
Ron and Ed explore the soul of enterprise.
Caleb and I explore fraud, which is more like the herpes of enterprise.
Go to wherever you get your podcasts and download
Oh My Fraud.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Klass. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Back once again in lovely Newport. Where are we?
Newport Beach.
Newport Beach. That's what I thought. I was okay. Newport Beach. It suddenly just didn't sound right in my head. Newport Beach, California, with the meeting of the minds. Yes. All right, Phil, you got a question for us? What do you got?
Yeah.
A little closer.
You've been talking about that you make it subscribing to the company, but then you're talking about later adding on things. I'm kind of not clear how you add on to something that's everything.
Add on something that's everything.
If the subscription is to
yep.
all the services we can provide, how do you then do add-ons to?
That's right. So you could certainly just set up a subscription that is all three offerings to include you get everything and maybe change prioritization. Maybe you get, you know, a 2-day response time, a 1-day response time, something like that that's changed about the process. But you can also in the model change what's covered and not covered. So while it would be great, what we're saying is when you have a subscription offering, there should be a top tier that includes all you can eat. The tiers underneath it may not include everything. Does that make sense? So you might have stuff that you withdraw. And that's why we want you to, instead of thinking in scope, out of scope, we want you to think covered and not covered for that. And you can pull some of those coverages out. So for example, Ron, why don't you tell the story? You were at Armanino. They would do, you would do insurance for in ERPs for if someone left the organization.
Yeah, they had this turnover insurance that was usually put in the middle or the top option that if a key person left, they would come in and they would train a new person, even help you hire a new person, and even put a person from their firm into that position until you found somebody. And since I was there, the trigger had never been pulled, but we sold a ton of that because the CIOs, the CFOs were like, this is fantastic. We're covered if we lose somebody. And I would think now with the great resignation, that might even be a bigger issue.
And also way more likely to have the trigger pulled.
Yeah,
true.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Right. And maybe that's not for you, but that's an example of something where that would be included in the top tier and maybe not in your second and third choices. Does that make sense?
But then you were also saying about to add the new things to the top tier first, which brings me back to my original question. How do you have an add-on to something that starts out as unlimited?
Have an add-on? Yeah, well, because it may or may not be included in the initial offering. Maybe I'm not understanding your question. So
I thought kind of the point of this, as opposed to like the KTAs and we've been talking about previously, was that you're putting up an offering that says, you know, this covers anything that we can do.
Right. But that might just be one of the, and you might have an offering that doesn't include everything that's underneath us. So
So then how would those things actually differ from, from the annual agreements that we're doing now that lists here's, I mean, covered, not covered is still scope in scope.
Yes, we'd have to probably talk about the specifics of it. So we'll take that one offline. Anybody else got some stuff?
Good. Yeah, the challenge I think with this, I've struggled with this too, is we're trying to move away from differentiating the options just based on services. And like for example, a DPC doctor, he really only has maybe two tiers, three tiers, depending on age. But as they add new things, they might add pharmacy, they might add diagnostic, a lab, they might add a chiropractor to their office. They may make that only available to a certain tier membership, or they may make it available to everybody. The point is, from the patient's perspective, when they see those new services, even if they don't access them or use them, it throws a halo over the value of the practice. Oh, wow, I could get genealogy testing or, you know, 23andMe if I wanted to. I don't want to yet, but I might want to in the future. So just like when Amazon Prime dumped all these new shows on us or new benefits like music and magazines and reading and all of that, even if we never access it, it's valuable.
Great. Yeah, I wanted to just give one more example that came across my desk earlier this week. And this is from Electronic Arts, the sports games, sports equipment. So they have decided to not re-up their membership with FIFA, the World Soccer Organization, because they were making it extremely expensive for them to do. But first note that Electronic Arts makes 71% of its revenue is based on subscription revenue now. So it's not based on game sales anymore. 71% of Electronic Arts is subscription revenue. And one of the things that they're doing as a replacement to this FIFA is this thing called Ultimate Team. And an Ultimate Team is what happens is each individual player competes for each other building players, so fictitious players that don't exist, that so they can build a player with the, and different things, and it goes into the game and plays games and gets experience points and all of the stuff that can compete against the other quote real players in there. But what people are doing is they're creating these players and then selling them to other players in the game. Right, so it's become an exchange unit of these, and so that's how they're replacing this notion of where we don't even have to worry about the real soccer anymore. We instead can sell you this AI agent to do this. All right, so what's the equivalent in ERP? I always find that there's some kind of an analog somewhere. What is it that you can create, whether this is an offering that is specific to that business or specific to that industry, a package set of reports that you know you've maybe developed for other customers that you're now putting together and now including this for all of your customers or for certain customers in there? So leveraging the stuff that you've done in the past as quote one-offs and creating libraries of them to access that other people can access. So I think that's a completely different way of looking at it as well, stuff that we perhaps haven't done before. So in a way, you're becoming a semi-development organization around the customization area. So
one last point I'd like to make is just this idea of experiences versus transformations. Transformations are the top of the value curve. It's the best thing we can do for our customer, because when you transform somebody, you take them from where they are to where they want to be. And when you transform, it's deeply personal and effectual. Think of the symbols that we have that shows transformations in our life, our wedding rings, our diploma, our CPA certificates, right? These are milestones that changed us, that turned us into a different person somehow. And we professionals have the capability to provide those transformations to our customers in a serial manner. I mean, we can do one after another, where when you look at a product like Ed's vacuum cleaner or Starbucks, how does Starbucks up its game? Now, Howard Schultz has created Starbucks Reserve. I don't know if any of you have seen these outfits, but it's a really high-end Starbucks. He calls it the Willy Wonka of coffee. But he's tied to a physical product, and that's an enormous constraint. We're not tied. When you provide a transformation, the customer is the product. And that's powerful. You can't do that with a tangible offering.
Yeah, that Starbucks Reserve is pretty impressive. They do have one near me in Dallas, and it's three different floors, and you have to navigate your way through. Now, the other thing, but regarding that coffee, one of the big subscription places is Au Bon Pain, right, is offering a coffee subscription, unlimited coffee. But what they find is it's not about the coffee, it's about the add-ons once you get in the store, right? So if they give you the coffee for free, but people come in there, get their free coffee, and then have some breakfast as well. So are there things that you can then create that get people a taste of what you do without buying everything, and then create additional offerings, something that's really a lower price, what's called a flanking product, to come in to get people to come on board and then show what else you have to offer.
Like, if you're really brave, you can subscribe to Taco Bell and get a taco a day. What is it, like 10 bucks a month or something?
I don't know that my bowels would be able to handle that.
Right? Not sitting right.
Probably not the best thing. Well, look, we are up against the Enron. We are coming here to the close of our show. Anything else you want to share with our audience before we take off?
No, just thank you, 90 Minds, for having us. This has been a blast. Thank you very much.
All right, as usual, I will see you in 167 hours, Ron.
All right.
This has been The Soul of Enterprise, Business in the Knowledge Economy, sponsored by Sage. Building experiences that connect, remove friction, and deliver insights. Catch us next week on our show at 3 p.m. Eastern, that's noon Pacific. In the meantime, please feel free to visit us at www.thesoulofenterprise.com.